Hi everyone, Dave Verdun here from innovationtutorials.com, making innovation practical. So as you know, patterns go well beyond repeating shapes and dance moves. And in the context of product development, if you understand some patterns, it can be really useful in advancing your offering and gaining a competitive advantage. So past patterns can also be great predictors of the future. So in this video tutorial, you'll learn how patterns appear all over and in places that you may never expect. You'll learn there are many different types of patterns, including social, societal, mathematical, visual, and most importantly, patterns that come from engineered systems evolutionary process. You'll learn how understanding patterns can give you an advantage over those who don't. We'll introduce you to the 8 technology evolutionary patterns from the trees methodology. We'll show you examples of each of these 8 patterns of evolution and why these patterns can help in product development.
You can either win, you can lose, or you can tie. But you can actually increase your odds tremendously because there are actually patterns in this game. Here are 5 patterns that you can actually use next time you do rock, paper, scissors. So here's a pattern. Winners, when they win, they tend to repeat their winning hand more than a random hand. Number 2, losers tend to change their losing hand. There are actually patterns for innovation and creativity. But there's a particular one we're going to talk about in this section, patterns on how systems evolve over time. Is there certain behaviors that happen on all systems? There's certain patterns, no matter what industry you're in, and he tried to capture that information so that he could leverage it on other systems. Then the next stage is rapid development. Some people call this adolescence. And it's often characterized by some interesting new little innovation that caused people to start realizing that maybe this is a good idea. Society starts to recognize the value of this because this now is a little more interesting, a little more practical, because one of the major problems of the original idea got solved. So continually make the numerator bigger and continually make the denominator smaller. So there's a whole lot of different ways to improve value, improve ideality, and we're going to show you 6. The first most logical way to improve this ratio is to work on the denominator. And reducing the denominator can be more than just cost. It could be all the sum of the harmful effects. So cost, noise, waste, any type of problems at all, etc. Another way to improve value, improve ideality, is work on the numerator. And you can argue a system is only good as its weakest element. I remember some cars that I had years ago, English cars that were really great cars, but the electrical system had tons of problems. And if you think about uneven development of subsystems or elements due to enabling technologies, a good example of that is in the automotive industry. Now we have light during the day, but we also have light at night. Next evolution probably was a torch. Somebody took one of those hot embers out on a stick and walked around with it. So now you have light during the day, light at night, stationary light, but now light can be mobile. You can walk around with it. Next might have been a candle. Think about the degrees of freedom in a seat. The original car seat had 0 degrees of freedom. It was bolted on and you couldn't do anything with it. And then somebody came up with the idea of putting a track on the chair so you can actually move it forward and back. It had 1 degree of freedom. And then somebody said, you know what, why don't we make the back of the seat pivot forward and back? So now we had 2 degrees of freedom. And if you look at today's luxury car seats, they have about 18 degrees of freedom. They're much more dynamic. And if you think about how computers have evolved over time, when the desktop computers were created in the 80s, they were much smaller versions, not nearly as powerful as the mainframes, but still quite adequate. And then they've gotten smaller and smaller and smaller. This is the latest one I've seen appear on the penny, which is a fully operating computer. One reason is to just get rid of difficult work, tedious work that nobody really likes to do anyways. They can automatically shift into a camera mode when you peer through the viewfinder. It's not going to be too long before we can
also be useful in solving current problems by changing the state of the current situation. They can help in technology forecasting, so you can